Good afternoon, everybody. In this talk, I will explain what is Zool and how it integrates with Pagure. My name is Fabien Boucher. I'm working for Red Hat in the OpenStack, in the production chain infrastructure team of the OpenStack group. I'm mainly focused on the Software Factory project, that is a software development forge based on Zool. But first, to give you a bit of context about this talk, me and my team are Zool operators, so we experience a lot about the innovative features that Zool bring to software development. So we decided to share more about it, and one year ago, we started to think about Zool and Fedora. And we quickly figured out that Zool should be able to integrate with Pagure. So we decided to write a Pagure driver for Zool. Then we started a proof of concept to experiment with the driver, but in a context of RPM packaging. So in this talk, I will explain what is Zool, how it integrates with Pagure. I will show some examples of the proof of concept. Then I will share my feeling about how Fedora could benefit from Zool. But first, let's talk a bit about the gating. The tagline of Zool is "Stop merging broken code." The fact is, keeping a code branch SLE is hard for many reasons. I mean by SLE that the last version of the code continue to pass the test suite of the repository or the project. Indeed, validating a patch can require complex integration tests that can be also artifact binding or even multiple nodes to run. And the problem is even worse when there is multi-patch or multiple pull requests to go through. And merging is a human process, and problems like miscommunication can lead to the broken master situation where the branch no longer passes the test. So to mitigate that, a simple gating strategy is usually adopted. So pull requests à la GitHub or à la Pagure are implementation of a pull request workflow. So a code maintainer can accept or reject a pull request based on a review, but also to help maintainer to decide if a pull request should be accepted or rejected, we can attach automatic testing to pull requests. And obviously, if a pull request does not pass the CI test, the automatic testing, the maintainer should not merge the pull request. But this simple gating strategy is flawed. Indeed, some time can pass between the pull request is approved and the time it is merged. And during that time, the target branch might have changed significantly enough that when you merge a pull request, it will break the code. In that case, the test suite of the project or the repository no longer pass, and it can take a significant amount of time to detect and fix the issue. And the problem is even worse in case of project composed of multiple repositories. And in that case, it will, to test a pull request and to merge it on multiple repositories, so multiple pull requests, it will require human coordination to avoid the breakage of the project. What should we do to improve the gating workflow? So first, approved patch, so patch that are going to be merged. So when I talk about patch, you can think about pull request, obviously. So when the pull request is approved, the pull request must always be tested on the latest version of the target branch, especially just before the pull request will be merged. Also, multi-repository and dependencies. The system must provide a solution for developers to specify dependencies across repositories, but also to define dependencies on pull requests. The system must be also able to preserve the approval and dependencies order when testing and merging pull requests. The gating process must be automated. That means that no human should be involved in testing and merging pull requests. The system must handle must implement a gating workflow and handle it by itself. Then the system must be able to scale to handle more projects, more patches, and more CI run. So let's talk a bit about OpenStack. So given the specificities of the OpenStack project, I mean lot of patch submission, really long functional tests, and dependent repositories. It was needed for the OpenStack community to build an innovative gating system, CI and gating system. So to do so, they have built Zool. And here are the main concepts they have implemented to it. So multi-repositories and patch dependency management. That means that the system allows developers to define define dependencies across repository, but also to use a specific keyword that is depends on commit message that allow to depend that help a developer to specify dependencies across pull requests. CI and parallel co-gating. So Zool is a job scheduler and job executor. That means that is really good to execute CI jobs, any CI jobs, but also it is a powerful gating system. When a pull request is approved, Zool will rebase the pull request on top of the target branch, make sure the test suite pass, then it will merge the pull request on the target branch if the test pass. Also, Zool, by design, is aware of every pull request approved on the system. That means that it is able to orchestrate the testing and merging process. Scaling, Zool is based on a microservices architecture, so it scales well. And also it is compatible with different code review systems like Gerrit, GitHub, and recently Pagure. On the right side of the slide, you have some statistics from the OpenStack CI. So Zool manages CI there. It manages around 1,500 Git repositories. It's about 10,000 jobs per hour. And around 10,000 patches merge every month. And it's worth mentioning that Zool is generic. It is not tied to OpenStack only, so it can be used in every project. There is other interesting concept and feature into Zool, so I will go over all the bullets. Zool implements event-driven pipeline. So Zool react to code review system event, especially event on pull request, and it will provide a way to trigger jobs based on specific events. Zool is CI as code. Indeed, 99% of CI configuration for a project is stored in Git repositories, and Zool will validate and gate those repositories, so the CI configuration. If you want to change the CI configuration, you can open a pull request. Then Zool will look at the pull request, load the CI configuration change, and handle it. And so that's really great because it avoids the need with other systems to merge a CI change, to see the effect, and eventually break the CI. And it avoids also the need to have a CI staging system. Zool jobs are in fact Ansible playbook. So that means that you don't need any agent on the test node, only SSH plus Python. As it is Ansible, it gives also access to the Ansible ecosystem. And finally, if you have any existing role that run in your CI, Ansible role, then you can reuse them directly with Zool. Zool support job inheritance, job dependencies, job chaining with artifact sharing. Zool support also multi-node jobs. In fact, when you define a job, you will attach a node set definition. In this node set definition, you can specify one or multiple hosts. And in fact, Zool will flatten this node set definition in the Ansible inventory of the job. So then, if you have multiple nodes, it is really easy to spread the task with Ansible across the nodes. Zool is based on a resource lifecycle management, that is NodePool. So NodePool provides a pool of test nodes that Zool will use when running the jobs. Each time a job starts, NodePool will provide a fresh node. And when the job finished, it will destroy this node. So it also produces reproducible job environment, and it helps a lot to eliminate CL flakiness. Zool also provides a secret management system that is really simple. Secrets are stored in Git repositories along with the CI configuration, but encrypted. And when you need the secrets, Zool will provide it to the will provide the specific secrets to the specific job. And finally, Zool is multi-tenant. So you can there is a strong isolation between tenants, and you can use only one Zool instance across for multiple projects. So now let's talk about the event pipeline. As I said, Zool react to a code review event, especially on pull request. So when a pull request is created or updated, it will enter the check pipeline. And when a pull request is approved, so prior to be merged, it will enter the gate pipeline. So on the left, you see the check pipeline. Each box is in fact a change. So a pull request, and each part here, you have some part in red and some other in green, some other in blue, is in fact a job. Here in the gate pipeline, we see the box expanded, and we see all the job running for that specific change. You can also define custom pipeline, like the post pipeline that will run jobs when pull requests are merged. Also, I said before that Zool supports repository dependencies and patch dependencies, pull request dependencies. So, for testing a pull request for a project, Zool will look at, for a repository, Zool will look at the dependent repository. And then it will check out the dependent repository of the repository the pull request is open on into the job workspace that make all the sources available for testing. So on the left side of the schema, you have three repositories, E, A, B, and C. And in fact, those repositories are dependent. They are part of the same project. And if a pull request is open on repository A, then Zool will check out repository A, B, and C in the job workspace, and it will rebase the pull request A on the repository, the pull request on A on the pull, on the repository on A. So as you can see, you have the dependent repository, and you have also the pull request into the workspace. You can also specify dependencies between pull requests. So on the right side, you have a pull request open on repository A that depends on a pull request on the repository C. And Zool will detect that and check out for you in the job workspace the three repositories, but with both patches rebased on A and C, repository A and C. And remember that in the gate pipeline, Zool merge pull request, so it will make sure to preserve the dependencies when merging. So Zool won't merge the pull request on A if the pull request on C is not merged. Now let's talk a bit about the gate pipeline workflow. So in this pipeline, this is pull request that has been approved, that enter in it to be tested prior to be merged. So as you can see, so pull request enter in this pipeline in the order of approval. So we have a patch on Nova that have been approved first, then a second patch on Nova, then a patch on Keston, and finally a patch on Nova. Nova and Keston are repositories, they are tested together because they are part of the same project, so they share the same gating queue. And in fact, each patch is rebased on every other patches ahead of itself in the gate pipeline. That means that the Nova patch 2 is rebased on Nova patch 1. Keston patch 3 include in its workspace Nova patch 2 that is rebased on Nova patch 1. And Nova patch 4 is rebased on Nova patch 2 and include also Keston in its workspace. So as you can see, Zool expects that functional tests, that jobs for those pull requests will succeed and all the pull requests will merge in this specific order. By doing that, Zool speculates on the future state of the repositories, and it helps a lot because it will speed up the gating workflow. But sometimes failure happens. So in that case, we have a job on the patch that tests the patch 4 on Nova that have failed. That can be an issue with the patch 4, but probably it is more an integration issue with the rest of the chain. Another example, here we have a job that failed on Keston on patch 3. In that case, Zool will invalidate all the subsequent runs. So in that case, it will stop the jobs for Nova patch 4. Then it will restart the jobs, but without Keston in the workspace, because Keston has failed. And as the patch on Keston has failed, Zool won't merge the pull request. It will report the failure on the code review system. Then the patch author will need to fix the incompatibility. And probably, without Zool, the patch on Keston would have been merged. And in that case, multiple developers would have been impacted by the issue because the master state of the repository composing the project will no longer pass the test suite. So that's why this tells that broken master, but at project level. But hopefully, with Zool, we detected the issue. For the other change, tests succeeded, so they are merged in the order of the of approval. And so, to sum up, Zool is able to use this speculative merging strategy, and it allows Zool to detect integration problems before the code is merged. Now let's talk about the integration we did between Zool and Pagure. So, as I said, Zool reacts to code review system event, but each code review implements different interfaces. So Zool implements some driver to interact with different code review systems. So Gerrit, GitHub Enterprise, and recently we added the support, so the driver for Pagure. How Zool interact with the code review system? So first, it should be able to listen to events like pull request open, pull request updated, but it should be also be able to act on the code review system, especially on the pull request. For instance, to change the pull request CI status, or to comment on pull request, or even to merge the pull request. Here is an architecture schema where you can see Pagure on the left, Zool on the middle, and NodePool on the right. So let's take an example where a pull request is open on the repository A. So Zool in the middle will receive on the Bagger event stream the event pull request created. Then the Zool scheduler will look at its configuration to check if there is a matching pipeline. If there is a matching pipeline, it will look if for repository A, there is some job configured to run on inside that pipeline. And if it is the case, it will look at the node set definition of the jobs. It will tell node pool to spawn the nodes. Then it will tell the Zool executor to run Ansible playbooks, so the Ansible playbooks of the jobs on the nodes. When the Ansible playbook process finished, node pool will destroy the node. Then the Zool scheduler will report the job result through the REST API of Pagur inside the pull request on the repository A. So it will report a CI flag, so is the pull request passed the CI or not. It will also comment on the pull request to give the link to the artifact. And in fact, in the meantime, Zool would have extracted the artifact into the log server. So now let's talk a bit about the proof of concept. We wanted to experiment with the Pagur driver of Zool in a RPM packaging context. Artifact sharing with child job. Our first scenario, we wanted to be able to build a package with a parent job and share the package, the RPM package, with child job. Child job will validate the package that have been built. So on the right side of the slide, you have a change box from the Zool statue page that shows the jobs in progress for the pull request 5 on Python Gear repository. Python Gear is in fact a disk-git repository. The first job, rawhide rpm koji scratch build, will build on Koji as scratch build, then retrieve the artifact from Koji, so the RPMs, and create a local repository on the test node. Rawhide rpm test and artifact rpm lint are child jobs. The first one will look at the disk-git if there is any functional test into it. And then it will take, if any, it will take the artifact built by the parent and run the functional test on it. So for this test, we have also experimented with the standard test interface of Fedora. And for the last job, again, we will take the artifact from the parent and we run a RPM linter on the build package. On the left side of the schema, you see this definition. So in the check pipeline for Python Gear repository, this is the jobs we will run, and not the use of the dependencies stanza. That means that the child job, RPM test and RPM lint, should not start if the parent job, RPM rawhide koji scratch build, has not finished. And that makes sense because we are waiting in the child job for the artifact from the parent job. So let's have a look to the parent job definition. So as you can see, this is YAML. So in fact, every CI configuration in Zool is all YAML. So CI configuration, but also Zool jobs, because this is Ansible. So first, there is name and description stanza. Then you have the role stanza that we tell Zool to check out the repository called Zool distro job into the Ansible workspace. In that repository, we have some Ansible roles that help for packaging, for RPM packaging, and those roles will be available for the run and post-run playbook. Run and post-run playbook are in fact the Ansible task that will run on the test node. There is also the use of the provide stanza that tells Zool this job will provide an artifact code repo. Also, there is a use of the secret stanza that will tell Zool to expose the following secrets to the playbooks. And here, that makes sense. We need secrets because we are going to build on Koji. We need to be authenticated. And then there is a node set definition So in that case, Zool will flatten this definition in the Ansible inventory, and it will make available a mock host inside the inventory that will be based on a Cloud Fedora node. A Cloud Fedora node is in fact defined in the node pool configuration. Yes, in the second scenario, I will use mock, but not for this one. Okay. We build a scratch build on Koji. Mm-hmm. And finally, some variable that will be exposed to the jobs. So remember, we wanted to share an artifact with child job. So this is via the provide stanza, the artifact repo. But we need to tell Zool what is this artifact. So if you remember in the job, we extracted the built RPM from Koji into a local repository. So we need to extract, thanks to the first task, the repository from the test node to the Zool executor node. Then, in the second task, we will use an Ansible module specific to Zool that will return some information about the artifact to the Zool engine, to the Zool scheduler. And in that case, this is an artifact called repo, with an attribute that is URL. And in fact, URL is going to be the URL to the artifact repository where we have the RPM. And how child job will reuse that? So both child job in their definition will require, using the require stanza, a repo artifact. So Zool will provide the artifact detailed in the jobs in the child job inventory. So this is a snippet from the inventory of the child job. So you see the information about the artifact, and you see also the URL to the RPM repository. And then it is really easy to have an Ansible task that will use the information from the Ansible inventory to create a YUM definition file. And then on the test node of the child job, this task will be executed and the artifact repository will be available. So then the child job will do the rest of the work, but they will have the artifact from the parent job. So to sum up, here we saw how easy it is to share artifacts between jobs with Zool. So this is the second scenario, pull request dependencies and RPM build require. Here we wanted to show the use of a dependent pull request artifact. So to do so, we have created a specific job that is able to build RPMs, but with the capability to handle RPM build require. So you see on the screenshot, this is a pull request open on Python Redis, this Git repository. And you see the use of the dependence keyword to the pull request one of Python mock this Git. In fact, Python mock is a RPM build requirement of Python Redis. So next slide, we'll see how we handle that. So the job we have built is Rawhide RPM build that use mock to build the RPM, so we no longer use Koji in that case. This job definition provide a repo artifact, but also require a repo artifact. And you see that the Python Redis pull request depends on the Python mock pull request. So the build package Python mock, build in the mock root, will be exposed by Zool to the job workspace of Rawhide RPM build of Python mock of the testing of Python, of the pull request of Python Redis. So in that case, to build Python Redis, mock will find the expected and dependent RPM build dependencies, that is Python mock. But Python mock pull request might have depends from other pull requests as well. And in that case, the built artifact of the other pull request would have been made available by Zool in the job workspace of Python mock, so the mock root, and Python Redis as well. So to sum up in this scenario, we succeeded to handle RPM dependencies pre-merge and speculatively for runtime on build. Last scenario, we wanted to give a try with fed message to run asynchronous job. Goal was to validate package built by Koji outside of the pull request workflow. Unfortunately, again, Zool is driven by Git and code review and is unable, as of now, to react and report on a message bus. So the challenge was to convert the message from the bus to fake Git repositories and have Zool run a RPM lean job for the fake repository. To do that, it was required to build some additional tooling. So we built a Zool gateway that is in fact a fake code review system, and we built a fed messaging consumer and producer. So the consumer read event from the message bus, filter them. We just want to keep the event from Koji when there is a build succeed. Then we store them in a backend, and finally we have the producer that will take the event and orchestrate the Zool gateway to create a fake repository, a fake pull request that will, by effect, instrument Zool to run our job, that is a RPM linter. Then when a job is done, the producer will report back on the bus. But in this scenario, we weren't able to report back because it seems we need to be authenticated. But at least, it can be complex, but it proved to work as expected. Finally, how Fedora could benefit from Zool? So don't take me wrong, I don't have the in-depth knowledge of the Fedora CI to tell that Zool can do a better job than any other CI system, but I feel that the innovative feature of Zool could benefit to Fedora in some way. That's why I would like to extend on some point. So multi-repository and depends-on. This makes the CI testing by far easier. The rebase and dependency logic is already handled for you by Zool. Any software developer can understand, again, it can provide event for project just spread across two repositories. But in a distribution context, we talk about thousands of packaging repositories. And everybody knows that RPM brings a notion of dependencies. So I think Zool can help a lot in that context. Co-gating, as a packager, you can specify dependencies between packaging change across repositories and have Zool handling them during testing, merging, and publication. So in some way, it is possible to gate RPM repositories with Zool. Cross-provider, as far as I know, most of Fedora repositories are hosted on Pagure, but some others are hosted on GitHub, so it can be good for the Fedora project to provide a solution for developers, packager, to specify pull request dependencies between Pagure and GitHub, and Zool supports that. Zool job plus Ansible. In fact, nothing more is needed to define a CI configuration. Zool brings a clear and understandable framework. And finally, CI configuration as code. The CI configuration is fully defined in Git repositories that make the CI configuration versionable and auditable. So, some links, if you want to learn more about the proof of concept, so on the Fedora wiki. If you want to experiment with Zool, there is some quick start. So the first one from the official Zool, from the Zool project. So this is the official quick start. But there is also another way to deploy Zool really quickly, a sandbox using the Software Factory project. And finally, there is a link to the Software Factory instance. So Software Factory is a way to deploy Zool and not pool. So this is the instance we use to work on the proof of concept. So that's it. Let me know if you have any question or comment.
So there's no running Zool instance and Zool service which I could use in my report just now. Do I have to start my own service?
No, there is multiple Software Factory instance that run Zool and not pool. So the first one is softwarefactoryproject.io. This is the one we operate, me and my team. So we can provide CI for anybody, in fact. So if you want, you can ask. And we have also for the RDO project, an instance of Software Factory. So that runs Zool and NotPool, that the RDO project is using. And we have also an instance internally at Red Hat. So this one can be used as well for private projects.
The Zool itself, can it be deployed in OpenShift, for example? Do you consider plans to deploy to CentOS OpenShift or Fedora OpenShift instance?
Not really for now. I know there is the work on OpenShift operators, but I'm not sure this is fully functional at the moment. But this is something that will happen in the future, especially to run on OpenShift. In the post pipeline, the job for the change will be executed in the order of merging.
Yeah, but I want the information about the group. So I want my post pipeline to announce not every change individually, but the whole the group of dependent patches. I want to do something with this, like create one announcement for the whole group of patches which I just launched.
I don't think you have this information in the job inventory. So maybe this is something that can be improved at Zool level, but your job can request this information on the code review system.
To find all
to find the dependencies.
Along this chain, yeah. The use case I have for this, for example, if you consider pull request testing and we have a set of dependent pull requests for packages, we do a premium check, we verify that it's all good and nice, we merge them all together to our disk, and then we would like to build them finally for Fedora, and we would like to create a site tag to put all these packages, all the components which were just merged into one site tag. So if we would have this information about the group in post pipeline, we would create a post pipeline which will create a site tag for this.
Yeah. So there is two solutions. First one is to not use a post pipeline and do it in the gate pipeline.
Yeah,
and the other solution is a new kind of pipeline, that is a promote pipeline. That's something quite recent in Zool. And at that level, this is not that the information is not that there is only a change merge on a branch, but we keep the information from the code review system. So we have still the information of the pull request. It's not just a commit merge on a change. So I guess at that level, in the promote pipeline, we can do something as well. Mm-hmm. But we need to experiment with it, exactly.
Also, is there kind of waiting mechanism for Zool where you can declare that this test result should be ignored by some reason, like my gate test is failing, keeps failing, and at a certain point I say, like, please consider this as passing and just go for it. No,
with Zool you should have stable
yeah,
jobs.
Yeah, there's a difference between like OpenStack with proper CI and all the rest of the world, because OpenStack grew to this point that failing test means failing, and there is no way
Yeah, but that's a good occasion to improve the test.
Yes, but like we still have a list as a required people want to have the option, like, you know, be backdoor.
Yeah,
to
but
pass through.
The pipeline configuration, so the job to be triggered in the check pipeline, the job to be triggered in the gate pipeline for specific repositories, is not a global configuration, so that can be set by repositories. So if someone does not have jobs that are stable enough for the gate pipeline, the jobs can be also you can put the job optional, so not optional but not voting. In that case, if the job is flaky, the result won't be considered.
But also, like, as a last resort option, I could just hit merge button manually. Very, very last.
You still have access to the merge button,
yeah, yeah.
But it will introduce failure if you start to do that.
Yes, I know. Unfortunately, we have users which have to.
Yeah, so
what is the user interface or interaction?
Alors, so on Gerrit, on GitHub and on Pagure, it's going to be a bit different. It will depend of what provides the code review system. On Gerrit, this is not called a pull request, but this is called a review. When you provide a patch on a project hosted on Gerrit, you will have some labels where code reviewer can set a note in a specific label. So usually there is a code review label where you can set +1 or +2, and there is a verified label that the CI, so Zool, will use, and also there is a third label that is called workflow. This is like the final approval. So Zool look at that to decide if it should take the patch and make it enter in the gate pipeline to have it merged. On GitHub, there is a reviewer approval, and this is coupled with the tag system on pull request. So if a pull request is approved by reviewer, and if it gets a specific tag, then Zool will detect that. It's part of the event of the system, and it will take the pull request, put it in the gate pipeline, and run the test, have it merge. So this is the way we control Zool, in fact. Yeah.
But gate pipeline starts when the person says that
you're ready
for the gate.
Yes, this is really important. In fact, most CI systems provide the check pipeline. When you have a pull request, you simply run jobs and you have a result. So that's great. But you have the job result at a specific moment in the time with a specific status. For instance, the pull request might be based on a specific commit, so this is what the CI system will test. But in the gate pipeline, we really want to test the pull request on the really last version of the repository of the target branch.
I'm asking mainly because there might be infrastructure failures, like you are downloading something from external service and it fails for some network connection, so how to actually rerun the gating or something.
So this is in the pipeline configuration. This is really customizable. You can tell if someone type as a command regate, then Zool will detect that command and put directly the pull request in the gate pipeline. Or if you want to reinforce a recheck, then the patch should go through the check pipeline, then again through the gate pipeline.
And then just improving. So
Yes, exactly. We can have a global configuration with project template. So this is a common set of jobs that are good enough for every project, like a bit of what like I showed. So the build on QGIS scratch build, then the retrieval of the artifacts, then some validation jobs. So this can be quite common. So we can propose people to use that by default. That can be done globally, but also by project. Then each project can add additional jobs. So project's definition will augment, will be merged on the common configuration. So.
But also some projects may say, like, I don't want even use polycast at all, and I don't care about the lead. I will just directly push it and go through. So we just will have this component not touched by Zool at all.
Yeah. In fact, we tell Zool in its configuration to listen to event, but for specific project. In the project definition, you can even say that it's going to be RPM slash star. So in that case, it will be every project. So recently in Zool, they have merged the capability to use multiple, to select the Ansible version job should use. So now we can use 2.8, so there is 2.7, 2.6.
So you can define it on the job level?
Yeah, at the job level, at tenant or job level. Any other question?
Any plans to support
GitHub? this is a question I think that comes really often in the IRC channel of Zool. So I think just someone need to tackle the task, but yeah. I did most of the work for the Pygur driver, so if GitLab is really needed. In fact, it will really depend about the API of GitLab. If the API we really need for Zool are there on the API, on GitLab, it will be really easy. The fact is for Pygur, so the Pygur developer is working at Red Hat, so it's quite easy to discuss and to have API change merge on Pygur. But for GitLab, it's going maybe to be a bit complicated.
But people will already have a more extensive API than before.
Yeah, so we need to look deeper at it, and it's probably possible.
Yeah.
So thank you, everybody.